manufacturing sector. India is ranked second in terms of manufacturing competence. The manufacturing sector in India has grown steadily and has been consistently generating a large number of employment for the last 5 decades. Currently, the manufacturing sector contributes
15% to India's GDP. A large number of companies are shifting their manufacturing base to India to make the best use of economic labor cost and English-speaking literate workforce. This is the right time in making India the economic hub of the world. However, the manufacturing sector's share in the GDP is gradually declining. India's manufacturing sector activity contracted for the first time in over 4.5 years in August. However, the manufacturing industry in India has all the qualities which enhance economic development, increase the productivity, and face competition from the global market. To discuss the future and the current challenges facing the manufacturing segment, ISBR has invited today Mr. Senthil Kumar, Production Head, Vicon. I would like to request Professor Abbas to facilitate our guest. Mr. Babu Yuvraj, Deputy Manager, Bosch. I would like to request Professor Bindu to facilitate our guest. Mr. Saurav Srivastav, Senior Business Manager, Emerson. I would like to request Professor Partho Ganguly to facilitate our guest.
Welcome, sir.
Now, our moderator for the discussion today is Mr. Partho Ganguly, Corporate Relations, ISBR.
Thank you. Welcome back, all of you. Manufacturing sector. Now, we read everywhere that, you know, that there's this term in this country which is called the GDP, and each sector must contribute something there. And somebody's contribution is rising, somebody's contribution is declining. All these things, various statistical parameters you will hear. But there will be some sectors which go up and then suddenly vanish. There are these sectors which have been steady, which have been there for God knows how many years and have contributed substantially to the gross domestic product. Manufacturing sector is one such very resilient, strong sector. You may be reading anywhere that, you know, IIP is fallen, as he said. It happens. But still, you have this representative from a multinational company operating in India. You have another representative of a multinational company. They are operating in India and are very, very confident that, you know, manufacturing industry is not scared. I don't think they're scared. It is just that, you know, market turbulence, all these things happen in every country that they operate out of. I was delightfully informed by Mr. Srivastav that his company, in the last 200 years of existence, hasn't suffered a loss. So if you can understand how strong this company is, and if they are continuing in India, it is because of the fact that India is a place to stay. Now, most of us who, you know, get into these careers, we follow on this track. But yeah, you know, I have an engineering degree. I get picked up from the campus into one of these organizations. I have a mechanical, I'm from a mechanical stream, so I must go. I don't do an MBA, so I must go into a technical area. But the confusion that I have seen, I have encountered the highest is people who, after their engineering, do apply or, you know, join a management course. Yeah? They are kind of confused, saying that, you know, where do I fit? Which is the industry I fit? Now, I am trying to, through this discussion, trying to bring out what exists in the manufacturing sector and how you guys could possibly see a map for yourself. We'll discuss about the challenges in this industry, the growth opportunities in this industry, and then they will probably tell you as to how you could find a fit. What do you need to do to find, make yourself employable in this sector? So please focus, and any questions after the session, take. Thank you so much. So, as I said, now we keep hearing, I mean, the press, courtesy of the press, we keep hearing all sorts of things. But, you know, manufacturing has been here since I know. Yeah? Do we really see a challenge today to the manufacturing industry? Can we have the mic?
Hiya, good afternoon to you all. See, first of all, myself also, I'm an engineer plus an MBA graduate and joined Emerson as a first job after doing my MBA and have been in this organization for last 7 years. See, what is a normal notion why people, as professor was talking about, we all as a consumers, at the end of the day, you being a student, he being a professor, are consumers. So you know industry which are used, products which are used by people. So that is one of the reasons why people know about banks, people know about FMCG products. You will know, everybody sitting here will know LG, will know Samsung in an air conditioner product, because you use a product. At the end of the day, there is a vast industry which stands behind a finished AC product which you use. Every there will be component from his industry, from my industry. Every air conditioner will, 90% of the business of air conditioners, we have our presence in the form of Copeland compressor, which is present. Copeland is an Emerson company which exists for number of years. So we know the end product. So first of all, this notion that the companies you know only exist and you need to find a job in that only, please remove it from your mindset, just because there's a vast industry which is behind. You may be knowing Reliance for mobile, but there are manufacturing setups of Reliance which are important. They use every byproduct which is available from the petroleum. So it is an opportunity for everyone of is huge. Moreover, this industry is a steady performer for number of years. Your consumption of capital goods will not go down. The kind of infrastructure growth what India is seeing today, the capital good required for that industry to make the national highway connecting all 4 or 5 major metros in the country, you need a vast industry at the background to create infrastructure what you want to enjoy. So those sectors will do exist in country. For any airport, for Bangalore International Airport, the way you see it today, there will be Siemens, there will be Bosch, there will be Emerson behind it. You may not be knowing it because they all have created the infrastructure which you enjoy. So this industry is bound. India do not still have more than 7 to 8 world-class airports. So these airports are growing, these infrastructures are growing. So there is a vast industry which is going to be in this sector. You know Airbus because it is a finished product, the flight which goes. But there are so many engineering products which go behind it to create the plane to fly. So that industry itself will not diminish, because to make the end product more more close to the consumer need. You need the background engineering which goes in number of engineering companies, number of manufacturing companies to make you the finished product what it is.
Okay, I'll go to Mr. Senthil. See, one is he's coming from the business development side. So I would take this question to you. After all this so-called media, you know, hype about crisis, financial crisis, and all that, how you look at the future of production, so to say?
Good afternoon. My name is Senthil Kumar. I'm an electrical engineer and having a degree of MBA in production management. And I have been working from 1992. 21 years I am having experience in manufacturing sector. I am a black belt Six Sigma, complied by American Society. As far as my experience, manufacturing sector will operate within control limit always. For the last 21 years, I have been seeing the manufacturing sectors. Professor's question is correct. The media is creating some news, I can say, because my company, I can say an example. We started our manufacturing here from 2007. And we, last year, we achieved 100 crores. And now our target is 120 crores, and we are in line with the target. Even though, see, there are some lag in manufacturing sector. Yes, I agree. You can see the present lag is only the investment sectors. See, because we are selling the AC drives for several applications. So one of the section is the building sector, I can say. So in the building sector, our orders are little bit less compared to, as compared to our first quarter. But other sectors are working fine. The manufacturing sector, I can say in very simple word, if you are stop taking the food, the same time manufacturing sector will close. So we never do that. We need food. Same thing, you need everything. See, you can see manufacturing sector is low, they are saying for the last 6 months, I can say. But you can see in behind your electronic city, Dottadagur, you can't get one apartment. Because in January I booked an apartment. I had been trying for last, I can say 3-4 months I was searching. I couldn't get one apartment because so many people, they are having money. They are working people. And we are saying that we are in lag. I can't understand where we are lagging. See, I'm traveling to abroad. Many of the people I'm seeing from manufacturing sectors nowadays. If you go, see, last week I traveled to Finland. You can see only 3 companies, they occupied almost 100 seats in the flight. ABB, Nokia, and Wasila. Of course, we, some 4 people. And last Tuesday, the Microsoft has occupied the Nokia. Officially, they have announced. So why I'm telling this? The manufacturing sector will change. See, it has changed from Nokia to Microsoft, but it will not stop. So you don't fix anything in your mind because you are a student, we crossed your age, and we crossed your level. And we also thought, I also started doing Java after my degree, and I joined 3 months and I worked for some computer, what do you call, software company. Even I didn't know what I did. So immediately I shifted to manufacturing. The manufacturing sector always will have that turbulence. I can say it's a positive turbulence, not negative turbulence. I have never seen, because I worked with SEZ campus, so I have been seeing more companies in SEZs. One or two companies, they closed because of their management, not because of orders. I never heard that any company is not having orders and they are closing. If they are not having orders, they are not working well. In even our sales meeting, the lag, it was for our market, our selling market, there was a lag. But what we are saying is, the AC drive business in a year, it's around 2,200 crores in India. It has down by some 10%. So it has come to some 2,000 crores. But we need 120 crores. Still we have opportunity. So we can't say that we are, the industry is low, our market is low, and we can't get orders. So our salespeople should not say, because in amount of 2,000 crores, you want only 120 crores. So you can't say that there is no opportunity. And attrition level, I can say, can come to the point. Attrition level, still in manufacturing, it is increasing. So it denotes the opportunities are more and more, becoming more in manufacturing sector. When I started my career in 1992, I was seeing around 2%, 3% attrition rate. Now it is almost 12, 13 in any industry. So there were the opportunities. As professor noted, that is the correct way. You should define yourself and you should have some goals when you are studying yourself. And by seeing only one news or the hearing by one of your friend, you don't think that industry is low, we will not get opportunity. It's nothing like that. So all the inputs you gather and output is with you. So don't worry about the manufacturing sector grown or not, the GDP and rupee value. And there was a small cover story in Business Time, I believe, 2 weeks back I read. The question is raised by the consultant, one of the financial analysts. So every people are talking about our government that our rupee value has gone down. The same government, it was operating 2 years back or 3 years back, when American and Europe banks are under crap, but Indian banks are in good condition. So we have very good people, and manufacturing sector will never stop. As Srivatsav noted the Reliance, I would like to say one thing, because Reliance has stepped into the cement business. They wanted to be a large production of cements in 4 years. They invested for one unit around 3,800 crores because we are supplying drives to them. We finished almost 12 crores order for them. So they are increasing their manufacturing sector. So you can see after four years, you can see everywhere Reliance Cements. So you can see everywhere the construction is going on. The people are not willing to buy, no business person will build the apartment. So I would like to say that manufacturing sector will never come down, even after 100 years also. So no need to worry, because we all running behind manufacturing sector. If it goes down, then we have to change ourselves. But we will never do that.
I would like to bring in Babu here. In terms of, this is my observation, so I'll share. Indian companies, the last about 17, 18 years that I have seen, have been very quick in absorption of technology, right? And so, we were already a low cost manufacturing center, and now the technology absorption, our productivity levels have zoomed. So, I mean, being a completely technical person, I would like you to talk about this and the fact that, you know, Indian minds are fertile enough to absorb technology. We have a flair for technology, I guess. So where do you see, and for anybody with a management qualification, how important it is to be technology savvy, to be able to understand technology and to be able to use technology so that they're able to fit in from that technology awareness point of view, even in a manufacturing setting.
Okay. Let me take the automotive example itself. Before 1990s, I believe, we know only few car models. Okay, Ambassador, Fiat, okay, and Maruti 800. After that, slowly people started coming into India. All MNCs got into India. They came with their technologies, which means that they used our workforce with their technology. And today, you can see every month we are getting new brand cars. It was not there before 1990s. It's almost every month we are seeing at least two models are getting released, which means it is very true. This technology MNC has brought in, and we are in par with their requirements. And now even Indian companies like Mahindra and Mahindra, Tata Motors, they are also setting a trend, getting technology as a big support with them, keeping technology as a backbone. Earlier, they were with respect to technology, they follow BMW, Audi, like that. Now, they are releasing with their indigenous technical things, which means that we are capable, and even Indian companies are growing. Which means order of the day is technology is really required to survive and to cope up with the MNCs.
Okay. Now, what we have kind of understood is that there are two, three aspects that they elaborated on. The fact that we never see a match for ourselves into the manufacturing setup. I mean, normal management graduates would kind of, marketing specialization guy, first choice becomes FMCG. Yeah? Whereas when I was talking to them, there are a lot of opportunities in the manufacturing sector. For even a plain vanilla management graduate with a marketing specialization. Now, he's sitting here, right? He represents the manufacturing sector, and he's a business development person. He's a pure technology person. He's a techno-commercial person, right? So what I'm saying is, you have these examples sitting here. Now, what I want to bring in right now, I would pose a question to these people as to how do we, as people who would be completing their management qualification, are likely to fit into the sectors that you represent. Yeah?
See, again, coming, before coming to this room, it was discussed that I believe you all are from the third semester. So you would have, I will talk more about the sales and marketing side in the business sector because I represent the same. See, in this industry also, the backbone is the people like Babu Ji and Mr. Senthil, where we have a setup as a manufacturing plant where engineering people design what the feedback we give from the market requirement. When you go as a sales and marketing part of into the manufacturing industry, it is slightly more different from the FMCG where the product is completely fixed. For PNG, the range of products are not customized to the customer needs. Here you will have more number of products, more, and that can also be customized. The sales period, the duration of sales is slightly longer, but you people might have been going through a sales management part in as your book if you people are doing into the market. So there will be the stages of 7 stages of sales to complete. One of the most important stages is prospecting, prospect. So this prospect generation in our industry will be more via the consultants, more via the reference, more rather than more by direct advertisement to the end user. It is the only difference between FMCG and the manufacturing sales is FMCG sales is more about pull strategy where I advertise, use Shah Rukh Khan to represent, to give an advertisement for a soap, or I use Kareena Kapoor to give an advertisement for the soap and create a pull in the market for my product. When you come represent a sales and the marketing side of an industry like Emerson or Vacon or anybody, you have an AC drive or a UPS or in data center, I cannot sell a data center by putting Shah Rukh Khan or Salman Khan in the advertisement. When you sell a data center, you go and sell your technology. You talk about there where there is where your inherent background of engineering, if you have, or if there are channel management into the marketing side of companies like Bosch, Emerson, or even Vacon. So when you represent that, you create a, it is where the push marketing comes into the, where I will use my technology to push my concept into the customer's mind and then sell my product. But the basic here also remains same. You need to prospect, you need to do the marketing. Marketing may not be the advertisement. Marketing here may be going to various exhibitions, going to meeting various technical consultants who will be drawing the project and will be speccing the product according to what is the best available based on your product, which is also available in the required spec. So here we are talking about push marketing rather than the pull marketing. But again, the same, when I also joined, there were certain questions, because when you read Kotler, it's all about FMCG, that why you put toys or chocolates next to a beer in a supermarket, that father buys beer, so he buys chocolate. But again, when the same piece, same value chain, what you have read in Kotler, if you apply in the marketing sales also, it remains the same. The difference only is, rather than a pull market, it is a push market. You sell the technical concepts rather than the packaging. You sell the product features. You sell, the sales duration is slightly longer because the process is push rather than the pull. I can only, but it is one industry which will always stand tall. You name an IT, the you see so many IT companies from Microsoft to Google to Yahoo. They will not be in this foray or in this world for more than 30 years. We are talking about GE, we are talking about Bosch, Emerson. These companies will be in this world from Second World War, First World War time. So these industries are the backbone. If they will definitely exist, and there is a lot of marketing and sales which goes on in these companies too.
No, I will, you know, I'll take this point as a, you know, I call this company old economy companies. Yeah, I mean, And I'm very proud to call this old, because I personally, I belong to old economy. That's cool. All right? So, and what I find in the old economy companies is the inherent strength to survive and grow. Yeah? And as a person who came with a technology background, and you've handled a technology role, but you've seen people with, you know, technology plus, you know, additional management qualification, you know, how's life for them in an organization like Bosch?
Understanding technology, being a MBA management graduate without technology, yeah, it is possible, but it will be easy if you are from a technical background. The world is changing, okay? And even the technology changes very often. So if you are a technical person, it will be easy for you to catch that very fast.
So all people who have an engineering qualification should pay special attention to this, all right? So these are opportunities available that you should be aware of, right? Yeah, go on, sorry.
Okay, maybe not related to this. I want to add up one more point to Mr. Srivatsa. Definitely India is a growing economy. In this growing economy, definitely there, all towns are growing, all cities are growing. You need infrastructure. Definitely you need infrastructure for all cities and towns to grow. And behind that, only manufacturing sectors are there. Okay? And these manufacturing sectors really need technology. Like earlier we use, if you see a off-highway machineries which is laying a road, if you see 10 years back, it's only a vehicle, off-highway vehicle only with a metal roller which lays the road, laid a road earlier. Nowadays, see the type of machineries what we have with L&T or all these infrastructure industries. Really technology has grown, which means that industry is also growing. If you want to see a big economy in future, definitely all this manufacturing industry has to grow with the technology. Without the technology, this manufacturing industry.
Okay, in Bosch.
Yeah.
Typical, you know, engineer MBA. What is the kind of role that Bosch would give them?
Okay, I related to my work. I have an MBA graduate working in my department. Mm-hmm. He is a product manager.
Okay.
He is not having a technical background.
Right.
But still, he works as a product manager.
Uh-huh.
He's not a technical. He will not worry about the technical things.
Okay.
He will get market demands.
Right.
Okay, and he will place the product with respect to the time scale.
Okay.
We call it as a product roadmap.
Mm-hmm.
What will be the technology for next 10 years?
Okay.
That
okay.
kind of roadmap he'll be laying.
Uh-huh.
But he'll be supported with the technical guys.
So he's actually directing the technology guys to follow that track.
Exactly. But he's not a he's not a technical person at all.
Right.
But why he is a big question.
No, I mean, he's probably looking at it purely from the business point.
Exactly.
Point.
Yeah. That's very much required.
Just adding to his point, see, 10 years back, professor started with a word called old economy. Yes, manufacturing industry do represent old economy, but there is a role for a new economy in it. It is not that. 10 years back, even the companies like Bosch, Emerson, Vacon were majorly focused on the engineering department and the R&D department. They create the product and they believe that it will be sold in the market on certain product features. But 10 years down the line, they realized, and companies like these companies started in his organization, it is called JMC program, junior management program in our company. It is called management trainee. A new MBA graduate joins Emerson as a management trainee. These companies realize that rather than only creating a best-in-class product, do not make them to grow and do sell the product. What they realize is you need a management graduate guys to go to the market, understand what the customer needs. It's not required that there are 10 people who will say, an example is, I'll just you a car. Why suddenly you see a so many range of products? From every month you will see a new brand new model being launched into the market. Why? Because people understood that there is a market. Everybody cannot buy just Maruti 800 because it's only available car in the market. So when the similarly in manufacturing industry, I'll again give you an example of say air conditioner. People realized there were certain kind of ACs which were being made. Then people realize when you are in a data center, the load density changes during the peak time. For example, a BPO process is there where US clients work in night. They have a data center. The data center may be having a peak, the servers may be doing the peak work in the night. So the heat density in a data center will be at the highest in the night. But during the daytime when the US processes are closed for the data center, they may be still running certain processes for Australia, for England, which may be slightly lesser. So they don't have the same density. So the cooling requirement of the data center is much less because servers are being worked slightly less. There comes what you today read is inverter technology in an AC or a digital scrolls and all those things. The compressor can change the capacity. A 10-ton AC does not every time consume the power and give the cooling of 10-ton. My requirement at this moment can be 2-ton. In the night, my requirement can be 10-ton. 10-ton, it can be because of the ambience. Sun is out, I require more cooling. Sun is not there, it is raining, I require less cooling. So the compressor starts working according to that. So for this understanding, you need a management graduate who went to the customer. He may not have the best. If you start talking to me on the complete technical side, I may not be knowing. But coming from the management side, what I understand is that customer need is power saving. Similar to what you read in Kotler, there is need, you convert it into demand, and then you convert into want when you sell the product. So customer need. And I created an edge over the competition by understanding that customer wants power saving. So the similar calculation of ROI made me sell my product. And yes, I had the engineering background in my organization, which had the capability to create a product reading customer need, as he has one management graduate in it. So similar salespeople would have conveyed to him that I need a product which needs power saving, which can change the power usage during the less work time and more work time. So these people with an high-end technical knowledge converted this customer need into the product, and that is how the role of management graduates come into the manufacturing kind of industry.
Okay, well, now let me come to Central. I'll like to know from you, now your role exactly, let's say, engineering plus an MBA, and you are into production, right? Operations, shall we say, yeah? Now, that's one more role available for a management graduate, correct? In the manufacturing setup. Can you elaborate as, you know, what is the kind of, first thing, what, there is one qualifications requirement that, you know, everybody knows. The other thing is, you know, there's a lot of hard work. There's a lot of hard work in the manufacturing sector because you don't sell by brand names like Infi, yeah? And nobody is dying abroad. You see, they will die if they don't find a BPO in India, yeah? But for you to create a niche for yourself abroad is basically on the technology competence that you have, yeah, and the branding of your product. So what I'm saying is life is much more tough for you guys than the IT community as such. So what I'm trying to say is work in manufacturing sector starts at the shop floor. So if you could elaborate as to, you know, where does a management graduate fit in the shop floor, and what is the kind of career growth? Because people, I'm sure people are aware of career growths in marketing. People are definitely not aware of career growths in operations or production.
See, in factory operations, earlier days, there were many Indian companies. Indian companies at the time in 92 to 97 I worked. So you can say only the production unit and maintenance department will be there. Then one personal department will be there. I couldn't see other than the any department, some R&D department, some companies. So at that time, there were very less MNCs, and we followed only the standards of our Indian standards. So we sold our product in India. So Indian customers' requirement fixed by some standards. If you see the electrical standards, it's called IEC standards. So we were running with three departments, but 5,000 people. So at that time, there were very less chance for the management guys to enter inside. But once MNC companies has come and we started selling the product all around the world, the WTO has come and we are also one of the competitor in the world. So we have to follow the standards. See, your product, if you want to sell in US, you should have UL approval. That is the standard, safety standard for the product safety, underwriter's laboratory. And if you want to sell your product in Europe, you should have CE marks. The CE mark and UL standard or other standards, you had to follow some procedures and process and control, then you can make the product and it can be accepted by the foreigners, customers. So now you see the factory is having many departments. We developed, it has been developed as a HR department. The personnel department has become HR department and public image. Then HR has been divided into now admin and HR. Now it has been again describing as IR, HR, industrial relations, human resource, and the personnel department and admin department. And you see manufacturing, they have divided into production, maintenance, quality. Quality has been again divided into incoming quality, final quality, and in-process quality. In-process has been divided into again routine inspection, stage inspection, final inspection. You can see the Bosch auto component manufacturing, they are following so much of very stringent standards because they have to adopt the standard, they have to comply with the standard, then only they can sell the product. So the opportunities in the specialization is more now. In factory operations, if you are a HR, earlier HR was doing only the attendance register and statutory compliances. If possible, he will arrange some training classes. But now HR responsibility and KPIs are different. You have to identify the trainings, identify the trainers, training you have to give, and recruitment procedure is very, very tough nowadays. Many people are thinking that HR job is very, very easy, but not so far. To get a competent guy, HR has to struggle like anything. He has to, even if he is approaching consultant, they will throw 30,000 resumes. In one day you have to select. So he will see only the, you have to see only the front page and you have to select the correct candidate. See, 3,000 resumes in one day, that also 2 hours, that is difficult. The technological, see, technical background people in earlier companies were more. But when we want to follow the quality standards and we want to step into the world market, global market, the specialization of the works and process has been well defined by the standards. Now, to do the specialized functions, MBA is mostly needed in all companies nowadays. I can say my experience or my career as an example. I completed my degree and I was working as a, I came up to assistant manager level or plant engineer level, I can say. After that, everybody has advised me to go for MBA. So I did in correspondence. My attitude, my communication skill, my confidence level has been increased and I came into the business level. See, now your professor is, I have not told him that I am a techno-commercial person to your professor, but your professor is easily identifying me that I am a techno-commercial person. So if you want to become a techno-commercial person, you should have MBA. Nowadays, MBA is mostly preferred by the employers, especially in the factory operations also. What we are looking, I will tell you. What I am looking for the factory operations. For HR and IR relations and admin, we need MBA. Without MBA, we are not calling for interviews. Then you take production. We have to implement so many systems in the process lines. If the person is coming with technical background, with 6 years experience in standard company, if he knows the standards or if he is certified by the certification body other than the course, I can say, see, I am a black belt, means it has been certified by some other body. It will be additional qualification for me. If I want to be become a general manager or CEO, I should have Six Sigma in operations. Same thing, if we have the degree holders with MBA, with the same experience, we'll give preference to the people.
Any questions on this? Any specific questions on what he's saying?
You can just raise your hand and stop us. You can interact.
Because in the morning, people were asking about additional qualifications. So in case you want to check on that, please feel free.
Okay, you can.
On their behalf, I ask you a question. Now, for a student with a qualification, as I said, now if I start doing a, you know, Six Sigma course, and then I come to you after I complete my MBA that I have done a Six Sigma course also. Do you prefer me or you?
Sure, we have to prefer. We have to prefer. And only thing, if you want to see, preference is different and winning is different. Just doing the Six Sigma projects, and if you are coming and if you are not answering properly or if you are not executing properly, then it is waste. See, in HR, if you study nowadays, the management, HR management, recruitment management is saying that 50% of the interview has been finished by seeing your CV. Your CV, we can understand 50% of your caliber if I am a good personal capability skill. And when you are coming, see, that is giving the opportunity to meet us. That we should not take that, that is a preference or that is the, we got a chance or something. So after that, how your execution, how you are answering the questions, how you are interpreting the your projects. Many of the people I interviewed almost, I can say some 2,000, 3,000 people in my life, BE, MBA people. But many of the people I analyzed that they are telling about their project, but the interpretation is very, very less. Very few people are giving good interpretation of their projects and they are proving the result. See, always analysis and improve. It should match. So what I am trying to say is, when you are doing MBA, don't stop your limit that you have done the MBA, you want to fix in one frame. Don't do that. You study more and more, you have a good library, you can study more about quality management systems. If you want to come in the manufacturing sector, quality management systems and Six Sigma, many quality tools, process tools, anything is available. See, additional, some of the people are having a different opinion that they have not completed engineering degree, but they joined an MBA. I can say only the, see, if I am receiving engineering MBA and degree MBA, if I am seeing the resume, I will call this guy first, engineering and MBA. But it doesn't mean that I will not call you.
In fact, that is my next query.
That is, see, I will say a very good example as he said. One sales guy, he was doing my earlier company. 5 years, he was the number one target achiever, and we given even excellence award to him. He's, I think, MSc Mathematics and MBA. But our product is the lighting product. So when I joined in that company called MDL Corporation, I joined a first person in that company. I started even putting the base of the cement floor and everything. Only one guy, I was the only one guy, I know the previous experience and technical things in the lighting industry. But many times, this person was challenging me in technically. Many times, many people, first 1.5 year, whenever they are stuck in even sales or service, when they are having some problem, they will call me for technically. But they started calling him after that. Because what was the thing is the attitude of the guy. He joined as a salesperson and he became a sales assistant manager, sales manager, then regional manager within 5 years. And he got excellence award. He is a non-technical person, but I can say other than the standards, technically he is stronger than me now. But even I am having 8 years experience in that. So when you are coming with a certificate, your attitude is more and more important. When we are in younger, definitely we will take all the things lightly. But you lost the years will not come back. See, what we did, the same thing you are also going to do in some different manner. So build confidence on you. And another one thing I will tell you. My MD is an MBA. He was the sales guy. But he knows technically better than us, I can say. He was a sales guy, but even when he is asking, even we can't answer. That is because of your attitude. I don't know whether he studied, when he studied technical and other things. And another one thing, everybody are saying that when you have finished BE and you no need to study anything, when you are coming into the company, the basic knowledge you can utilize. That's all. But you have to study more for the products. Otherwise, you can't stand in the company. See, I can say in the study period, I can say some 10 to 15% it will help the basic knowledge. They are calling. So nowadays, they started upgradation. Like software, you have to upgrade yourself. See, last 1 year, I studied this Six Sigma and I completed. I was the student till last week. So I can't say that 20 years experience, no. Like professor will study more advanced things, then only he can teach you. So attitude is important. And factory operation side, you have plenty of opportunities. And sales, as Srivats have told, we need more MBA people.
Okay, now, both of you talked about a management trainee program, right? Now, are you in the management trainee program looking at, firstly, is the management trainee program, say, about a year's duration, or is it more, or is it only a sales-oriented training program, or?
Hire management trainees even for the factory part of it, because in any manufacturing setup, now the lead time management of the all our products are made to order products. It is not
customized. Okay.
So when you talk about there are processes, when you these days most of the companies will have SAP or Oracle implemented. So when you convert a sales quotation, it is all managed from the lead till the final sales order what you punch. Factory takes it into production. They give you when the date is. You need to find out the exact match between when I want the product for my customer, when they can give. So the managing the total inflow of the all the inventory required for making the finished goods till the time of delivery, from logistic to everything, today is very well planned in any industry. And we do hire people not only for the sales part of it, but also for this management of completing. See, today the entire focus of industry is customer focus, customer satisfaction. Customer satisfaction, till the time a salesperson does, he tries to do or he tries to show the product in the, it's all a representation of product by the way I speak, the way I, but finally customer receives a product. So the entire process, when you go to a company which is reputed in an industry, you don't need that salesperson committed that 20th material will be delivered. And on 20th you communicate, now on 30th it will come. The entire process is which defines the satisfaction of customer, where every industry is today thriving for a longer duration and the profitability. So everything is related to it. So the entire process, we have people who are from the management background, how to take the sales order, how to create the production of line, preferences of the products. There are projects which are closed today, but the product required is 6 months. So you need to close the pricing with your supplier to make the finished good.
Saurabh, would a management trainee be considered for, say, after he completes the training, would he get an opportunity to things like supply chain management?
Definitely.
Same, I had opened the question to you also.
Yeah. Okay. Let us take the example of junior management program. What we have at Bosch.
JMP in Bosch, junior management program in Bosch. He's talking about that.
Yeah. a student after completing MBA, he attends interview and then he is placed in a small kind of job with career path set for him, which means down the line 2 years he will not be doing the same work. If he's doing also, then he's not upgrading himself and he'll be thrown out. It means literally he will frustrate with this job if he don't upgrade himself. You need to go up in the ladder, which means the career path is set. And we believe in Bosch, if you have a fundamentals right at your college and attitude right, at least it, and you can easily grow in the ladder. That's why we select MBA students for this JMP program. And the results are also proven. This program is there for almost 5 years now. And I see people joined us in the assistant manager, that's the entry level. Now he is in a senior management level.
In how many years would that be?
That's close to 4 years, 4 to 5 years. Which means?
So it's a kind of foolproof career progression system.
Exactly. And you'll be thrown out also if you don't perform well.
Yeah.
That's very obvious in all organizations.
That's very fair. If you can get promoted, you should be also ready to get the sack.
Yeah.
If you're not good.
Okay, which means that they are the persons who are going to lead the company in the future.
Absolutely. Any questions?
And you can also ask whether the technicals can't reach that ladder. They have a specialist path set for them.
Yeah, in fact, this is something that I've heard in companies like Motorola. Motorola is, zero error company. Yeah. So they have these two ladders. I think Nokia also has it. It's called the technical ladder and the management ladder.
Yeah.
And I have seen it about 15 years ago in Motorola. So people have the option, if you have a technical background, to continue doing technical work, and your pay is hiked, your designation is hiked, but looks different.
Exactly. There's no conflict between these two ladders.
Yes, absolutely.
Means a specialist will be a specialist, and yes. he'll be given, it's like an honor to him.
Absolutely.
And it doesn't mean that he'll be paid less. He will be paid and respected,
yes,
and treated equally.
So that's what I'm saying.
It's a different track.
A lot of people have this confusion that, I need to be a technical guy or I need to be a commercial guy. And in this confusion, they go nowhere. Yeah? So to make these people understand that each one has his own world, right? You're stuck to technology, right? You're stuck to business development. He's a combination of both. So, each to his own world. Yeah? So it's basically your own, I think, calling, and then you take it forward. Yeah, your question.
First of all, a very good evening to you all, sir. My question is the Indian management program applicable to all the students from different colleges of MBA, or is it only specific to various other colleges?
No, it is open to all. It is open to all, and you need to, there is several rounds of interviews, and it is not a face-to-face interview also. It is like in case study, and topic will be given, and you'll be given time, and then you'll be preparing for that, and you'll be coming to the panel, and you'll be presenting there based on your performance. They will call for the next round. It's like that's the initial round. Then there's a sequence of interview procedure for that.
So does this program only one specific field, or it varies?
The people are placed from quality department. It's almost an entire department. We have people placed in quality, R&D, even in R&D and in manufacturing, and even in HR. They are placed in all the place.
Thank you, sir.
Any more?
Don't stop learning. That's the biggest thing. Don't stop learning. The environment will be new for you. The product will be new for you. Being an MBA, you should not think that you should not go into technical. Unless otherwise you understand, it doesn't mean that you need to go and then do calculation and nothing like that. You need to understand the product. You need to understand the customer requirements also. Being an MBA student, you should know the product, which means that you should not stop learning.
Good evening, sir. My name is Pragati. I wanted to ask a question. Sir talked about additional qualifications like Six Sigma. You said you did Six Sigma last year. Don't you think it's better if we do Six Sigma once we get into the workplace so that we're able to implement it in a better way rather than doing it now?
See, in Six Sigma, there are two, three levels. Okay. See, Six Sigma has been found by the, I think, some martial arts guy. So that is what he put a grade in the belts. Okay, it was yellow belt, but in India they were doing green belt and black and master black belt. So I did with the US organization. So there were yellow belt. In karate, if you see, yellow belt is a learner. And green belt, you can just demo. You see, whatever you are, you know the martial arts. Then if you demo, then you will be graded with the yellow belt. Then the brown belt will come. Brown belt, you have to attack only one person. And what the way you are attacking, whether you are winning or not, that is different. What the way you are blocking, what the way you are attacking, then the brown, first, second, third degree, then black belt, you have to attack the group. Like that, Six Sigma is having different type of belts. Now you don't need to go for a black belt, but you can go with yellow belt or green belt. Green belt is the project if you are study, if you are doing in the classroom. See, we did with catapult. I think catapult is nothing but the old, what do you call, old weapon. There were, you had to pull and put this some fireball or something, they will pull and throw. So what we did is the green belt, first phase, you had to throw and you had to measure and you had to change the settings. Then you had to analyze. Suppose if you want to fix with 50 meters, what settings you have to do. If you want to put it in 10 meters, what you have to do. That you have to analyze. Second phase in the vertical wise. Okay. Third phase, the force. Then finally, what they will do is, they will give only, I can say, 1 hour to you. And they will fix the catapult there. Then this mic, suppose if you take this mic, they will not show the distance. Only this mic you have to attack, they will give 3 balls, different balls. You have to do the statistical analysis because when you are in war, at the time you can't measure and you can't do that. You have to analyze and you have to fix the settings and you have to blow. Then only you can open the door of enemies. So this is the classroom you can do in the Green Belt project. Then when you are entering into the manufacturing sector, I can answer her question. What he told is, I agree with that. Don't stop learning. First you listen everything. Listening skill, nowadays, it has been reduced everywhere, even to me also. So first we have to improve the listening skill. Then you analyze whatever you listened. Then you ask questions and clear the doubts. Then you start like this type of projects. But I can say you can join in any Indian Statistical Institute. They are offering very good classes. In India, they are the best people for the Six Sigma. So you can join the Green Belt. I think cost may be around some 10,000-12,000 rupees, I believe. So you can do the project, but when you are doing the project, really you should know how you are collecting, what method you are collecting the data, what method you are analyzing, what is the, how you are interpreting the result by analyzing. Then you can easily do with a black belt. Any questions?
My question is, what are the opportunities of a marketing fresher? What are the opportunities we get as a marketing fresher in the manufacturing industries?
You want to work in manufacturing?
Yeah, sure.
But you, no, I
marketing jobs in manufacturing.
Marketing jobs in
manufacturing, manufacturing industry.
I think.
There are plenty of opportunities. As I in fact joined my company as a management trainee and have worked to come to this place. So what the opportunities when you come, we generally prefer freshers in our industry as a management trainee, because as both of them were adding that you need a bit of technical knowledge. In a sense, you may not need to design a product, but you need to be able to have technical knowledge good enough to explain what has been designed and to understand what customer needs, and if certain modification to the design is need, whether they are the viable. So you need certain technical knowledge. So we generally want people to have a in his company or in my company, a growth path for a fresher is defined, because we prefer to people to exist for a slightly longer version of type, because it, unlike the FMCG sector where you can just what you have learned in your book you can go and implement, here you have to implement your management knowledge with a bit of technical knowledge and then convert your technical MBA knowledge to how well you can convey your technical knowledge is more important. So in this sector we prefer to have a fresher who has an ability to learn, who has an ability to listen and understand how to have that basic technical knowledge. And within 6 months you gain that. It is because you don't need to design it. You need to understand and have an ability to convey. So once you learn it, then it is a normal sales process. It is no other thing involved in it. So we, companies generally in manufacturing industry, will still want, with the iteration rate and everything, will want people in sales manufacturing to come as a fresher and continue for some time and grow up the ladder, rather than having latching people at the lateral level and growing them, because it becomes slightly difficult.
Thank you very much.
Good evening, sir. So I have a question. What are the scope for finance students in manufacturing sector? Just like you've told about the marketing guys, is there any scope for finance people?
Sure, there are scopes in any. All these manufacturing companies are sound financially. In any company, the similar ratios what you maintain, what is your working capital, what is your turnover, what is the receivable period, what is the period what you get your payments from the customers. These all, matlab, to be a very typical example I'll give of my company, our incentives are not only for the sales incentive. Our incentives, annual incentives, are divided into basically four incentives. One is the operational profit incentive. One is collection, what we call DSO. DSO is the normal, say, any, the sale collection amount to be collected. Should not be more than the 30 days sales, which is an ideal scenario you want to maintain. Then inventory management, because the total outstanding for a company is the inventory plus the outstanding in the market. You need to control it in a manufacturing and in the growing economy where cost is also becoming an important parameter. The role of finance do comes into the major.
So freshers are having chances.
Freshers are having chances, but again, it is a place where you need to spend some time, rather than it is not a, you don't read those, you read, you may be going through courses which reads about what is different kind of insurances. So you generally go and you understand what is mutual fund, what is this. But when you come to a manufacturing industry, there are certain things you cannot cut the cost of a product only by reducing the technology. So with the enhancement, what are all parameters you need to contain? It is again a field where you need to spend some time.
Yeah. So what are the major challenges that HR are facing in the manufacturing sector? What are the major challenges that HR facing in manufacturing sector?
HR.
I believe he will be the best person.
I already said you, HR is the challenging job nowadays.
HR is having majorly now three divisions, recruitment and training, then admin. I can say that recruitment and training is most important in the HR management. Because training is not a one-way training. Training means in that part subtitles are huge, I can say. See, when you are joining, what orientation, HR orientation has to give, departmental orientation, then you come for the introduction training, then on-job training, off-job training. So these all are the training for the newcomer. And the existing people, to increase the competence level to the requirement of the functions, the training should be arranged. So training can be arranged easily by the HR, but the evaluation and the evaluation result and interpreting the result, then you have to see whether the training is effective or not. The evaluation and effectiveness of the training. Then the recruitment. Recruitment, if you meet any group HR guy who is really working to catch the people, that is mostly difficult. Nowadays, very, very difficult for the senior people to get the senior people into the line. The HR is doing all the circuses, I can say. Because we are getting calls like from HR, like loan people. See, they will say so many SARs to us to attend for interview. So it is a very, very highly challenging job. And HR job nowadays, I can say, vacant. Rajesh, I think somebody knows. He's flying to Finland like anything nowadays. He's a HR, MBA HR. Because his exposure level in MNC companies in manufacturing sector, HR exposure level has been increased. Earlier training means if any person is working under me, if I am telling some training you have to arrange, he will arrange. That is what earlier culture. Now MNC culture is group HRs. So all the company, we have some 5-6 companies in the global, all the HRs are having some forum in the online. So every month they will meet through live meeting and they will update their competency level of the factory people as well as sales people. Then face-to-face meeting at least twice in a year they will do. So HR, you have many, many challenges, I can say, and you have to upgrade even if you join in HR and if you even pass 2 years, you can't simply sit. You have to study more. Then only you can upgrade into your level.
Just adding to the point what Mr. Senthil was saying. See, one of the biggest challenge for an HR in a manufacturing setup is that unlike IT sector, if you go to an INFI, you get 90% of people working or almost 95% people working there from a similar background at a similar pay package. When you come to a manufacturing sector, you have a biggest challenge that you start from a worker who is shop floor worker to the vice president level. So you have a different people from varied background, varied education level, varied demography in the terms of economic. So it's a huge challenge to maintain, because a factory will have a different challenge in the terms of union and all those which you people must be going through. Then there are legal department in all the manufacturing sector. There are, when you sell your products, there are legal clauses. So every PO is scrutinized on the legal aspect of it. So there are roles for the HR. Again, manufacturing industry and all are growing in that segment of taking the input and take understanding the importance of HR. So it is again a very growing sector for people of HR background in the management, because manufacturing industries are now actually realizing more the importance of HR today.
Adding to the same question, age is also one factor. In the manufacturing industry, a guy is passing 10th standard and getting into apprenticeship program, and then you will be in, then you will be parallelly doing diploma and finally completing engineering also while working, and his age will be around 40 when he promoted as an engineer. And the fresh engineer, in parallel fresh engineer joins the company, and he'll be around 22. So both are in same place now. HR plays a major role here to bring them in parallel. So this guy will have a rich experience, and the other guy will have a very sound technical knowledge. Okay, and we need to arrange separate, HR need to arrange separate programs for these two different set of peoples. I feel that, which I see in my area.
That's a tightrope that the HR person walks.
How can I see my future in a manufacturing company where the engineers work in HR department?
So, he is looking at an opportunity in manufacturing company in HR area. So he is asking whether does he map?
In HR role, you definitely map. Maybe the course of hotel management can have a not so direct relationship with the manufacturing industry. Until unless it is a manufacturing industry of food product, we all three don't represent, but there are two manufacturing industry of food product. Today all your packaged products of MTR and what all you buy, they have a huge industries to do this. So you definitely, if related to this, it more relates, but your HR knowledge, what you gain in the MBA program, works even for a normal manufacturing company. But if it is food related manufacturing company, maybe your background also works.
Hospitality sector generally would take you. Yeah. But as he says, he is mentioning specifically the food manufacturing industry. One to add to him, do manufacturing industry hiring people? People who are responsible for hiring, would they kind of treat him at par with a BCom, or would he be treated as a professional course holder?
See, once you enter an industry, I would have not taken interview of 2,000 people, maybe only till my experience I would have interviewed close to 50 people. But the major thing what people see while recruiting people is attitude more than this, more than your education background is kind of a mental development what you would have achieved during your MBA program, and it brings forth your ability to learn what happens and relate what you have read in your books to the real world. But ability is there when you do a program like MBA. But as a recruiter, when I am coming, If I am taking an interview in the entire room, the ability is almost common in all of you coming to the academic side of it. The difference what people look forward is an attitude in an individual, because that attitude will only help you to convert your ability and map it to the real world problems and take it forward.
Problems facing by the FMCG companies and the dairy industries.
Understand?
What are the
in Indian conditions we are talking about, in FMCG industry in India, the biggest problem is supply chain. The kind of infrastructure what we have for the dairy product or the FMCG, which generally the infrastructure, the cost is high, transportation takes longer duration of time. So that is why you need to supply a, just once you move out from metro, and again insisting because infrastructure available in metro is quite different to, if you go to Hubli in Karnataka again, you don't find a mall. You will have a different world, but you will find a Pepsi, HLL or your PNG products there. So their biggest problem is in today's market in Indian is infrastructure. And the other challenge, maybe it is an opportunity also to all these industries. Customer preferences have increased. Earlier there used to be 2-3 soaps available. Today customer wants specialized product for his specialized requirement. So they have to be innovative, they have to be creative and proactive in sensing customer need and creating product. Just an example, the same challenge can be an opportunity. One of a person was an Intel distributor in Bangalore. He moved to US and started the dosa batter called Swastik batter. Today it is $300 million company for him, and he caters to only 4 US states. So he saw an opportunity and created it. So the challenges are there, but the same challenges are to be converted to opportunity.
Adding one more knowledge base to when all the knowledge what you are gaining is to when you come out from this institute and you work, you have the ability to map the real world situation based on your knowledge. So these are all mental development programs. So you are equipped with what CRM talks about, and you can meet a customer or take up a challenge with the knowledge of CRM in you. But this course do make more sense when you are in industry, to me, because it adds value rather than right now you will read it as an education book that I have to clear a course and it should help me to gain a job. But once you have worked for in say 2-3 years, you will realize what actually is CRM rather than sometimes it can, people in sales can also find it as a hindrance that every day I have to create one list in the CRM where all I am going. I may not prefer to do it. So when you, in real world, you will have to teach the importance to the people working under you that why you need the knowledge from CRM.
There are more opportunities and there are more improvements in supply chain nowadays, because the supply chain has been modified 2 years back. Earlier it was called as supply chain management. Now it is called as logistics functions. Even manufacturing is coming under logistics functions. There are 3 sections: customer scope and after sale service and logistics function. Under the logistic functions, from the inbound logistics to outbound logistics. That means you are buying the material to make a product, so inbound logistics, and you are shipping the product to customer, that is outbound logistics. So wall to wall, they are calling as a logistics function. So under the logistics functions, supply chain management is coming. So you have to source a vendor, get the material, approve the vendor, evaluate, assess the vendor, approve the vendor, and get the material from them, buy some logistics way, and you have to check in incoming in quality, then you have to store into the stores for production support. So these all are calling as a supply chain management. But now supply chain management has become wall to wall. Till you are loading into the truck or till end to the customer. See, our product, we are seeing that supply chain management is a, after commissioning only we will close the supply chain management. So supply chain management is the huge subject. It is not indicating only one function. Supply chain management, there are lean management, there are Kanban systems, push and pull systems. Many type of systems are available to adopt supply chain management in a good way. So there are very, very good opportunities in supply chain management. And in manufacturing industries, if you have some supply chain management program, if you study, definitely your CV will come into the front. So no doubt at all.
We are coming towards the end of the panel discussion. So I would now, you know, first of all, I would like to thank the three gentlemen on the stage for giving us such piles of information that probably if we can collate and store and use, I think we have a good opportunity that we can sense in the manufacturing sector. And in the morning, we had these people who talked to you too, or talked about how to invoke the blessings of Lakshmi. And last, about 10 days ago, we had the Vishwakarma Puja, which is the God of manufacturing, right? So it's a proud privilege to have three Vishwakarmas here. So I thank them for being here and adding value to our people here, to all of us. Thanks so much.
Now I'll request Professor Abbas to say a few words.
The story is about what the sector is into and what their company is into and how they were able to leverage the opportunities what was there in the sector. So it's just a start for you all, and it's not the end. What the session they have come, it's not a conclusion. It's just an eye-opener. It's a window to see how you can open up the door and get into it and take the opportunities. So this is the first step what we have been trying to do, okay, having a panel discussion on different sectors to see how we can connect you all to the right career and the right profession. So it's a great opportunity, Saurav, to see you here, Babu and Senthil. And in fact, it's a weekend. You all might have had prior commitments or plans with your family or some special occasions, but spending time with our students, igniting their thoughts, and you know, opening up some sort of, you know, opportunities for them to explore. It's a great moment for all of us here at ISBR. Thank you, Vansen, and thanks a lot, and especially Partho. And especially Partho, who has been, you know, working hard to see that, you know, this panel discussion goes off smoothly and comfortably, making the students, okay, that energetic to see that, you know, they are consistently keeping their enthu up. So thank you, Partho, for making it successful. And and the people who have worked on the background, Bindu, the placement coordinator, and the student coordinators, all of y'all from last 3-4 days who have been putting efforts vigorously and making it successful. So let's hope so. The objective of such sessions is taken forward. It's just not a conclusion. It's a start. Let's make it successful. We'll have a good placement season. We'll have a good year ahead. And y'all start your positive thinking from this session onwards. Thanks. Best of luck. Do well.
Before I conclude the session, I would like to share a very good piece of information with you. While these gentlemen came in, I was sitting in the boardroom. So I had a call from Coke. They want to meet our marketing students for career opportunities with them. So I would like to, like all of you who have taken a marketing specialization, to think about this and talk to Bindu. We'll share further information on.
More thing, very important. So the guests who are here, probably immediately after this, you can meet them and try to get connected and see the next, whatever time you are there in the campus or off the campus in your career. Keep exchanging your knowledge or thoughts or experiences with them. So see that you are in touch with them, okay? Yeah. Have you felt that? Morning we had a session on finance sector, now we have a session on manufacturing sector. It just took a week for us to decide who would be the panel members. Probably, if I'm not wrong, when I spoke to Yuvraj yesterday, he immediately said yes. When I spoke to Senthil a couple of days back, he said yes. When I said to Saurav, he didn't expect invitation also, he said upfront yes. So that is the way, see, after such a long years of experience and investment of time, in the industry, people still feel, okay, yes, we have to go back and connect to students. So that is the passion, what it comes out of people, going to the field and understanding how important is education. So realize you're just starting the career now. It's the first step. So whatever they are giving an insight about the sector, imagine like it is a practical experience what they have gone through and understand it. So it looks very easy to listen, feel it through what they are speaking, but practically, going through it, it's a big challenge. And making a mind or having a mindset set for it, again, it's a big challenge. We ask questions, but it is just a question. We feel like it's in a classroom or it's in a session, we listen to it. But for that question, it has taken years for them to answer it. Am I right? Absolutely. I feel it is just not a day or an hour session to answer that question. It has taken years of experience to make a feel of it. So, I was just listening to Saurav, Babu and Senthil, the depth what they have, the expression what they gave about the industry, the manufacturing sector, definitely which is a more stable and you can say the oldest sector which I feel I have been seeing even before my education or my childhood, where I've seen people, who started just with ITI and gone up to senior post. So, but if you meet such people who have come from the root and touched to the highest post, they'll share the real experience out of it. If you ask an IT guy or a person who has come from a retail sector, who has had 5 years or 2 years or 3 years experience, definitely, you'll get a lot of the big jargons about what the industry is and all. But when you see the real people, who are from the manufacturing industry, who started from the root with ITI or still lower qualification, they express you with the real, what is required out of a talent. So, what I want to say all is, this sessions, whatever we are conducting, it is just not to see that, you listen to them, you understand the sector, but it's more importantly is like, you need to see where you map yourself. Because today we choose specialization like finance, HR, marketing or supply chain or operations, but are we really fit for it? Are we really taking a right sector? Are we taking a right specialization? So that's very important. The people who are here, they have taken a decision sometimes back, around 10, 20 years back, and they are right now here on the stage, and they are speaking about the success.
This is what I feel that I've achieved at the end of the day. I try to make my students think. I think sometimes I make them think. That's one part. Sometimes they make me think. Or more times. Some think thinking is too much work. They think they have to think too much. Right? Then, here is where we come. Their grade shows how much I think they have, and they have actually thought. Right? So, how much of first three align this to that? First three, the last statement, the first three. Because when you see the results, we might think that the student has failed. But how much time we think we have failed? Is something that I want to highlight also. Because when we are reflecting on self, it's much more philosophical, much more enriching than reflecting on others, always. And we tend to see a mirror for our own assessment, right? So why do we not see that? So we have to think on this aspect, that where we have failed and how we have failed. And I think this gives a kind of a way forward thinking. And the last point that I want to say is about this. So what is now? Thinking about three aspects. One is the conceptual thinking of classroom management. Second is your experiential knowledge, which you already carried with your past and come to a classroom as a student and now as a teacher or the faculty. That second part. And third is the possibility of having a philosophical frame, in the sense, a guiding frame to see how one could assess a classroom and ensure that thinking, creativity, innovation takes place in a classroom. Where do you stand yourself in terms of thinking about it now? In a sense, now I'm trying to apply my own statement. Have I made you to think? If I made you to think, what is your response to that? What is the personal philosophy that you think? You can capture it in few sentences or one sentence. What next now? You know that there are problems there. So how would you address that? You addressed in between also in the class, the discussion, that you were telling that you used techniques of, you know, understanding students, you used case studies and etc. You used, but now what next? How would you go about philosophizing or thinking about classroom management beyond theory in practice? What is your initial response to that?
Student focused, more of student centered.
Student centric learning. Yeah. Okay.
So make students think, we need to enhance our knowledge first,
okay.
Make ourselves perfect, yeah.
Okay.
So that we are able to invite with them correct knowledge.
Correct knowledge. Okay. So you take the lead. Okay. Any other things that you want to think about, for example, in interdisciplinary, for example, understanding the notion of that framework, ontological framework, feedback that you think about, that you could evolve? Any thoughts on that?
Sometimes use of case studies after the session. Suppose my first module is on 8 to 10 topics. So I would like to take up a case study after the 10th topic based on the first topic. To know if the memory is still there or they've forgotten. To know how good they are able to connect what they've learned about the first topic after the 10th session.
So within the syllabus, you want to see that.
There are many cases, you know, where we can always connect to what we teach.
Yes.
Because what we see in the market, Philip Kotler, you know, he's written about buy two, get one free, 20 years ago, which is still happening in our market.
Yes.
It is these academicians, you know, who give...
Only thing is numbers have changed.
Yes, numbers have changed.
Yes.
yeah. Or 10% extra has become 20% extra now. But they are using the same thing.
Yeah.
You know, innovation they are using.
Yes.
It's been invented by Philip Kotler.
That's
they are innovating today by making some changes in it.
Yes.
That means they have always referred to Kotler.
Yes.
So only those people have been successful. Tata Villas are there, Ambanis are there. You know, I have heard about Dhirubhai Ambani, how he was the first person to issue the shares to the public, because those days private companies were very few and government used to focus more on government's company. But today it's a super hit. So there was somebody who started it, an entrepreneur is a creative thinker. So I will use his case in the class.
Yeah, that's one way of doing it. So your philosophy would be to not check, but to see how memory is traveling.
Yeah, how they're able to
and then how they actually connect.
Yeah, so that learning happens.
So the skill of or competence of connecting with the syllabus.
So that, you know, after writing exam, they shouldn't forget, okay, management, the MCT is over, forget it,
yeah.
Enter the new subject.
Sure.
You know, so that they implement it.
Yeah. So definitely. So, yeah. So this ontology which I show, maybe after a few months or a year or so, some of you could share your own experience with that ontology, because you can always enhance it further. Because I have maybe highlighted only few which is experientially loaded with my own background, but maybe you can add
to that and see, or you can take out some parts to that and see this doesn't work, or it could add this part. So it also helps, you know, evolving that model. You can use that as a base for your own day-to-day activity. And then this is what I think personally is classroom management, summarize to some extent about what I was trying to say, which is the personal philosophy which I was talking about. It is something within self, and self which is motivated, self which is passionate, and self which is very much
perfect
in the sense of saying that we are aware about what I'm telling.
Yes.
Because in a class when the student asks a question, and if you don't know the answer, because the age of today is mobile technology, they can always Google certain things in the classroom. Yeah. They will ask you a question, that something which is you are not aware of. It's always good to be
here. Just zooming all the rooms,
yes,
all the shrubs, and just arguing with me. He's telling that, okay, sir, you are just teaching what I'm getting from
the book. Yes, yes.
But that kind of variation they are doing,
yes,
right?
Yes, right.
Nowadays.
So we have to catch up with them,
yeah,
and go beyond it. In addition to that, what I was trying to highlight was that if a student asks a question, and if you're not, aware about the question, I would simply say, I'm sorry, I'm not aware about it. I'll get back to you.
And
then right?
Yeah,
so that is.
No, it's perfect.
And exactly.
We'll be watching that whether we are.
Exactly.
But that we need to.
Yes.
That.
So that's the way you develop a relationship.
Yeah.
That's what we say in classroom.
Yeah. And the question should be taken in a positive way.
Yes.
I also see teachers reacting. They question me.
Yes.
You know, they take it in a negative way.
Yes.
When the student questions, then they take
well,
it in
I
a negative way and they take it personally. I've seen that happening.
So that attitude of I know everything
the student
is
gets,
the problem.
You know, dejected.
That is where we need to, that's why the idea of this discussion was that we come to a dialogue on these issues and everybody of you hear each other and share some aspects which are happening outside the world, which I was trying to bring in and then share from you. So it was a good collaborative kind of thing. And if this works out here, then why not in a classroom?
Right.
It's also something that I wanted to conclude with.
Yeah.
But I'll keep the slides for your own reference and you can share. But I'm more interested in your ontological framework eventually. If you have one, please share. And if not, then we can use this and see how it was helpful. As a pilot, it's interesting. I'll be more happy to see the response. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yes, Professor Kanak Raj, to please present a memento as a token. We have his email ID in his presentation, so if anybody wants to be connected, I hope you don't mind about that.
I'm looking forward for that reflection that you are gained here, because that's where I will learn, and I would like to be lifelong learner.
Thank you so
much.
Once again, thanks.
Thank you.
I would request all faculty members to please be at the back for a group photograph, and after that, we will be proceeding towards library for the lunch.